Well, good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you here this morning to the worship service. It's been kind of confusing. We've changed the plan several times, and you guys know me. I'm not good at the announcements, and I always make it confusing when I'm up here, so that will be added in as well. We don't have many announcements. I do want to kind of ask you guys, remind you about what we do at Goodwill the second Tuesday. Is we go and we do some sort of program, and we have it lined up now. We have someone for May, but if you are interested, if you have some sort of talent, you want to go and sing or dance or whatever, get with me so we can, we want to bless the residents there. They really enjoy it, and they will not, I sang there, and they will not, you know, boo you off the stage or anything, so you can do it. It's a good opportunity, and it really is a blessing for you when you go and do that. So get with me about that. If you are interested, we'll get you signed up for a month. We're trying to get where it would be 12 people, 12 different or groups of people. That way they're getting to see different people, and also it kind of doesn't burden any one person. Second thing is we're still kind of looking for some help with First Look, to just be kind of an assistant, another person there to kind of help. You're not necessarily leading, but you're helping with the kids, and that you can also get with me about that, or one of the elders. So, all right, next thing. Oh, we've kind of taken a break from the elder videos and the Bible moments the past couple weeks because we had communion and then Easter, and just kind of felt like, we wanted to dedicate the service just to those things and not really take away from it. But we're going to get back into that today. So we do have an elder video, which we'll show, and then I'll go into the Bible moment after that.
My name is Dale Mass. My wife is Darlene, and we've been attending here for several years together. Even before we were married, we attended here, and we have four wonderful children, and they're married and have families, and we've been really blessed in that aspect. Yeah, Titus approached me as far as being elder. I have some interest in that area. Some of it stems back to also being a commission chair for Fellowship and Service. I enjoyed being used or being a part of Cherry Glade in that aspect, and it's something that I thought I could continue as far as being elder also. And I just find value in fellowship and service in a church body. And it's something that I like to see not only continue, but also an area that I'd like to see Cherry Glade thrive in, and also as a ministry tool as far as reaching those that we come in contact with in a fellowship and service aspect. Another area that that is near to me is small group part of Cherry Glade, and I see that as being a form of fellowship. But it's something that my wife and I, we kind of, something that we can kind of do together. And now you're gonna have to edit that out. Some of the roles that I play is trying to maybe find people with a passion that for a ministry here at Cherry Glade, and see where a good role for them to be involved at Cherry Glade is, whether that be on a committee, or whether that be something that a ministry that they see a need for. I do I do get to, I always enjoy speaking to individuals in person rather than on telephone. I just enjoy having a conversation with individuals and just finding out, you know, what their passions or interests are here at Cherry Glade, and then maybe trying to find that ministry or committee that they can thrive or what's the word I'm looking for? Enjoy, you know, ways that they can be effective when it comes to ministry here at Cherry Glade. I'm excited about the new structure that the leadership team here is looking to implement. I think it has value in, I'm not opposed to what this structure was before, except that I think we can move forwards and be more effective as a church body. Instead of trying to find individuals that fit a certain job description, we can find individuals with a passion, or individuals can come to the leadership team with something that they see a need for or have a passion for, and we as a team can direct, give resources, maybe in some way help, make that ministry happen, or just come alongside. And I just think there would be real value in that. In a visitor's situation, they'd feel welcome, and they would experience, you know, the love that we have for each other here at Cherry Glade. I do appreciate the leadership that we have in place here at Cherry Glade.
You can't say that, you are leadership.
I know. But even though I'm part of leadership, those that are on the leadership team, I feel, are well suited to me. Just being there and being part of the meetings, just to see the involvement and where each person is on the team, that it's just a good match, and I do feel that that good things will come of it.
All right, it looks like Nathan did a lot of editing on that one. I'm not sure, but I have a Bible moment that might be a Bible few minutes, because I have a lot of things kind of swirling in my mind after some events this week and then Sunday school this morning. And so I want to share. Our reading was in Acts, it was chapters 1 through 5. But I want to start out by reading something from John chapter 16, which I had a meeting here on Friday, and our Bible moment came from John 16, and we had some discussion about it. But I want to tie it to Acts. So in John 16, Jesus is talking, and he's talking about the work of the Holy Spirit, and he's warning his disciples that he's about to leave, and he's warning them about that they're going to be persecuted. And so picking up in the second part of verse 4, it says, says, "I did not tell you this from the beginning because I was with you, but now I am going to him who sent me. None of you ask me, 'Where are you going?' Rather, you are filled with grief because I have said these things. But very truly I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you." And so we had talked, most of our discussion was about some of the things that Jesus says that the Holy Spirit will do. But one remark that stood out to me is, like, that's a hard thing to believe, that these disciples who got to see Jesus face to face and interact with him and hear, be there for his ministry and have a really intimate relationship with him, that it's better when Jesus leaves and the Spirit comes to them. And so, picking up in our in Acts chapter 2, we read about the day of Pentecost, and so the disciples are all together, and there's this violent wind that comes in, and they see these tongues aflame, and they are filled with the Holy Spirit. And then they go out, and they're talking and teaching all these Israelites, and there's a lot of nations represented there, and each nation, they hear their native tongue, and they're confused how these Galileans can speak all these different languages. And some are just amazed, and then some are thinking that they're just babbling, that they're probably drunk. And then Peter addresses the crowd, and he says, no, they're not drunk, it's only 9 in the morning. And he begins to kind of connect some dots. And so he starts out by quoting Joel, and I'm just going to read one verse out of that. In verse 17 of Acts 2, Peter quotes Joel, and it says, in the last days, God says, I will pour out my Spirit on all people. And once he quotes Joel, then he goes, beginning in verse 22, he talks about Jesus. So he goes back to kind of past history, and then now he goes to really recent history, and he talks about Jesus. He says, fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. And that's what we celebrated last week with the accomplishment of Christ on the cross, and then him being raised on Easter Sunday, Resurrection Day. And then after Peter tells them this, he quotes Psalm 16, a psalm of David, and he talks about, David in that psalm talks about the coming Messiah, and that the Holy One would not see decay, that speaking that he would be raised from the dead. And then he continues to talk to these Israelites, and he says down in verse 32-33, it says, God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, and has poured out what you now see and hear. So Peter addresses the crowd. He starts back in, this is what Joel said, and then he talks about what Jesus did, and he talks about what David said about the Messiah, and now he says, listen, it's not that these guys are drunk or anything, but it's you're seeing this Spirit being poured out. And so as I was thinking about this, and we had a discussion in Sunday school class about, you know, how the Holy Spirit works in our lives and how God is active in our lives, and I went back to what Jesus says in John 16 and how it's hard for us to think that we're on the good side of history. I know for me, it's like, man, if I was in the garden and I was walking with God, you know, I wouldn't let some speaking serpent, you know, deceive me. Or if I got to see that pillar of cloud or pillar of fire, it would be so easy to believe. It would, you know, kind of cast out all doubts. And but we have a whole, you know, Old Testament full of stories of people that got to see and experience amazing things, and yet they turned from God. And then we have the disciples who got to be right there with Jesus. And, you know, of the 12, there were 3 individuals that really had a more intimate relationship. Peter, John, and James seemed to have just a closer relationship with Jesus. And, you know, they got to go to the Mount of Transfiguration and different things. It seems like they were a little bit closer to him. And Peter, who's addressing the crowds here in Acts, he denies Jesus. I mean, he was really close to him, and he denies Jesus, and then he's the one sharing about the Holy Spirit. And so I think it's sometimes hard to believe that what we are gifted with through our faith, when we are given the Holy Spirit and the work that the Holy Spirit does in us, it's hard to view that as being better than being right there with Jesus as the disciples were. But I think, you know, looking at Peter, I think we can see that that's true, that we're on the we're very blessed to be on this side of the cross, and we're very blessed in being given the Holy Spirit, who works in us and through us and counsels us and seals us and protects us. And so I just was kind of thinking about all these things. I don't know if you followed the same way I did, the same trajectory, but thinking of that and really wanting to understand how blessed we are to be gifted with the Holy Spirit. And so I'm going to pray for the offering and the worship and also the message. So let's pray. Father God, we are grateful to be here this morning and have this opportunity to come together as brothers and sisters in Christ and worship you and praise you and learn more about you. And God, we just lift up today's service. We pray that you would lead us in worship through Trevor, that you would strengthen him, that you would just allow us all to really focus in on your glory, that we could understand how worthy you are of our praise, and that we could offer that up to you with hearts that are in the right place and focused on the right things. God, we pray that we pray for Matt as he brings the message, that you would be with him, that you would empower his words, that you would prepare our hearts to receive what truth you have for us here today. God, we are grateful and thank you that your Spirit works in these ways, that you speak to us and that you live within us in that way, and that you guide and protect us and you seal us. And we're just grateful, and we don't want to take that for granted. And we just pray that your Spirit would move here this morning. We pray that as we receive the offering, that you would bless each giver. We just pray that we would give with thankful hearts, that you would multiply the monies received to your glory and to further your kingdom. And we just give this service to you and pray that you would be honored and glorified here today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you, if you'd like to, you can go ahead and stand and sing to the Lord. Down your life.
who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is a very love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free.
Lord, we thank you for all you've done through the cross. We thank you that we have your Spirit. We thank you that you see us and you love us. You encourage us daily. Father, we invite you more here. Let's sing that chorus one time.
This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, we sing for all that you've done for me.
Amen.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. You are the one. Always hunger for.
morning, I was struck with the fact that the last thing that Jesus says to his disciple Peter before Jesus, at least in the Gospel of John, is follow me, follow me. And I was reflecting on the prayer that Jesus had with his disciples in the upper room when he says, I'm about to leave, but I'm one with the Father. Follow my commandments to love God and to love me. And just this continual follow me, follow me, follow me. But it will be hard and it will be tough. But I'm giving you an advocate, a helper forever, the Holy Spirit. And this week in particular, sometimes as we follow Jesus, we just need the Lord so much. And I just invite you to wherever you're at, whatever you're facing, to sing, Lord, I need you, in light of following him. The chorus goes, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you. Lord, I come. I confess. Bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. The sin runs deep, your grace is more, what grace is found, that's where
comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Oh, Jesus, you're my
greater ways than what we could ask or imagine. We love you, Lord. Thank you for your grace. Amen.
Well, good morning, Cherry Glade. I am very honored and glad to be here with you. It feels a little weird being up here and not with you down the audience, but nonetheless, I'm really excited to be here and I'm honored. I really do believe God has given me a message to share with Trey Glade here today. So I will jump right into it. I have a lot to say and not a lot of time to do it, so I'll jump right into it. So about a year and a half ago, my good friend Daniel and Lynette Sisler came to me, Michelle, and he asked us if we would like to join their missional community group. And in this group, we had one purpose alone, and that was to share the good news of the gospel to the community of Grantsville. And one of the very first things we did as a group, we went through this book called What is the Gospel by Greg Gilbert. As you can see, it's pretty small. It's a very easy read. I would highly suggest reading this book. But prior to reading this book, as you can see, the book is all about what the good news of the gospel is, I thought to myself, you know, Matthew, by the grace of God, you have been a Christian for many years. By the grace of God, you've been saved from a child. You grew up in Cherry Glade. You have a Christian family, Christian friends. I probably should have a pretty good grasp on what the good news of the gospel was. So I thought to myself, prior to reading the book, the good news of the gospel is that God will forgive your sins if you believe in him. And yes, and amen, we know this to be true. We know that there is forgiveness to be found in God. But as I thought about my statement of the gospel, I kind of thought to myself, why am I accountable to God? What is sin? So it seems I have part of the gospel, but not the complete big picture of the gospel. So I thought to myself, maybe I just need to be more vague, more broad maybe. So I said, the good news is that God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. And once again, yes and amen, God loves you and has a plan for your life. But once again, I was scratching my head, what is that plan? And what did God do with his love? So it seemed, again, I have part of the gospel, but not the complete big picture of the gospel. And therefore, I was so surprised with how much this book helped me see the big picture of the gospel. And I guess here's my fear here today. My fear, if we stop my sermon right now, and we have each Christian come up on stage and have to answer the question of, what is the gospel? I am sure there are many people who are here today who could do such a good job at that question. But maybe you're like me, and we have bits and pieces of the gospel, but not the complete big picture. And that can be really dangerous, because if the gospel is like a treasure map, if we only have bits and pieces of the treasure map, we might get lost along the way, or we might go down some tough terrain we were never supposed to go down. Or because we live in a time and an age where everyone knows of Jesus and has their own idea of who he is and what he has done, there are surely wrong ideas on what God has done. And the last thing I want to do is leave here today without the big picture of what God has done here on earth. So I have two hopes for this sermon. One, I hope that we can have a clear picture of what God has done here on earth. Why do we have good news? And again, it's all about the big picture here. And then two, I want to talk about what does this mean to get the knowledge of the gospel into our heart, into our gut, so that it may lead us in life. So that's the plan for the sermon, or the hope, and here's the outline for the sermon. One, I'll very quickly tell you what the good news of the gospel is. We will look at Revelations 4 and 5 to dissect it, and then once again, we'll talk about how do we get this into our heart, into our gut. So what is the good news of the gospel? I believe, and scripture would back me up in saying that, I believe the gospel hinges on what I'm going to call the four pillars of the gospel. What does the gospel say on these four pillars? So the first pillar is God is a righteous creator, two, man the sinner, three, Jesus Christ the Savior, and fourth, faith and repentance. And these four elements can be found throughout each book of the Bible as God is trying to show us what he is doing here on earth. And so why did I pick Revelations of all the books to kind of go through? I like Revelation because it gives us a clear picture. I like picture books a little bit more than like reading a book, and Revelation gives us a really good picture of the gospel. And so before we jump into Revelations, let me give you some context. So John, the disciple of Jesus, is the author of Revelations. He is the last disciple standing. All other disciples were killed over this good news of the gospel. And they actually tried to kill him too by boiling him alive. But by the grace of God, he was saved. And since they couldn't kill him, they sent him to a remote prison island. There, God came to him with multiple visions for him to write to Revelations. And here, we're going to be jumping into one of these visions. And in this vision, there are these heavenly creatures proclaiming a truth upon God who is on the throne of life. And here's where we will be jumping in. So please turn with me to Revelations chapter 4, verse 8. Okay, verse 8. Day and night, the heavenly creatures never stop saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne and who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who sits on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They lay their crowns before the throne and say, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being." So here we are being introduced to the very first pillar of the gospel, which is God, the righteous creator. And once again, these heavenly creatures are proclaiming, "You, God, are holy, holy, holy. It's the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." To completely understand what is happening here when these heavenly creatures are saying, "You, God, are holy, holy, holy," we must understand that in Jewish literature, anytime a word was say back to back to back, that is the same thing as them saying that word is a perfection of that word. So when they're saying, "You, God, are holy, holy, holy," they are proclaiming, "You, God, are the perfection of holiness. You are perfect in holiness. You are the bar for holiness. In you is no evil, no deceit, no wickedness." But not only are they proclaiming this God to be holy, the perfection of holiness, they're saying, "You are the perfection of holiness throughout all time, who was and is to come." So we can go back to the very beginning of time and see that we have a holy, holy, holy God. Here in this moment that John is having this vision, we can see God is a perfection of holiness. Here today, we have the same God on the throne who is holy, holy, holy. And for years and decades to come, God will forever remain holy. And that just kind of begs the question, what is holiness? Holiness is someone who is worthy of complete devotion as one perfect in goodness and righteousness. So God is perfect in holiness, perfect in goodness, and perfect in righteousness. And because he is holy, 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 we see that he is worthy of our complete devotion. And we actually see this to be true in Revelations, for if we reread it, we see that "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being." So Revelation is saying because he is the perfection of holiness and because he is our creator, creation should be in right subject, in right submission, in right worship to this holy God. And on the surface, we may want to buck against this because we live in a time, in an era that tells us we look within ourselves, not look upward, but look within ourselves, find whatever desires you want most, and you let that define you, you let that drive your whole life. But that's not the case in Revelations. It's telling us we should be in right submission, in right worship to this holy God. And when we take a step back, we see that this is the best news ever. For he is truly a holy God. For when he creates rules and orders, for when he says, "Yes, do this," or "No, don't do that," it is all for his glory, for he is truly a holy God, but it's also for our ultimate joy. So we find when we walk in right submission, right worship to this holy God, he is glorified, and we find ultimate joy. But not only that, we actually see this actually playing itself out in creation itself, because he is our creator, we are his creation, we are in subject to him. If we go back to Genesis, we're in Revelations, why not go the whole way back to Genesis? It says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In 6 days, he created light, sky, dry land, seas, plants, sun, moon, stars, creatures of the sea and creatures of the air, animals that lived on earth, and humankind was created in his image. And after each and every single day, he proclaimed it to be very good." He was well pleased with his creation. For everything he does, it's for his glory and for our ultimate joy. But not only that, so everything here is kind of like more tangible. We can see it, we can feel it. But he actually created some untangible things as well. On the seventh day, he rested to show that men and women should work for 6 days and rest for one. For his glory, for our ultimate joy, he created the Sabbath. How about marriage? He looked at Adam, the first human being ever created. He was alone, and for God's glory and for our ultimate joy, he created Eve for marriage, that we now have marriage here today for our His glory, our ultimate joy. And from extension of that, we see family, we see brotherhood, sisterhood, community, friends, all forming for His glory and for our ultimate joy. But not only do we have a God who is on the throne, who is holy, 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 perfect in goodness, perfect in righteousness, and not only is He creator of everything, we see that He longs to be with His creation. For it talks about in Genesis, He would walk in the cool of the evening of the garden with Adam and Eve. For He longs to have a relationship with His people for His glory and for our ultimate joy. And this is the kingdom of God that He has established here on earth, where He is on the throne, He is holy. Everything He's doing is for His glory, our joy. We should be in right submission. We find right joy when we are under that. And we have a relationship with Him. And I wish we could just stop here and just talk forever more about this kingdom that He has established here on earth. But for those who know your scripture knows, this kingdom soon becomes tainted by sin, thus entering the second pillar of the gospel, man the sinner. So the question is, what is sin? And to do that, we should first go back to the very first time sin enters into the garden. So if you want to, turn to Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God has made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say, 'You must not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the tree in the garden, but God did say, 'You must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and if you touch it, you shall surely die,'" or you will die. "You will certainly not die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and it will be like God knowing good and evil." When the woman saw the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She gave some to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. And then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked, so they sewed the fig leaves together and made a covering for themselves. So the question of sin still remains, what is it? Sin is a rebellion against God's perfect ruling and kingship, and it is an accusation against God's perfect character. Let me say that again. Sin is a rebellion against God's perfect ruling and kingship, and it is an accusation against God's perfect character. So here with Adam and Eve, we can see how they have sinned. So God gave full authority over the garden for His glory, for their ultimate joy, to Adam and Eve, and said, "You may have it, you may take care of it for your joy, but I give you one rule, and that you should not eat from the tree that's in the middle of the garden. For my glory and for your ultimate joy, you shall not eat from it, or you shall surely die." And I believe this tree was planted to remind them that they find ultimate joy when they realize that they're not God, but are walking in right worship to this God. Yet, here comes the serpent, and he starts throwing accusations against God. Did he really say that? Is God really truthful? Don't you know this fruit, when you eat from it, you'll be like God, knowing good and evil? Don't you know that He is withholding something from you for your own good? Don't you know that you are a better God than He is? He is unfaithful. So we can see when Adam and Eve took and ate the fruit, they rebelled against God, His perfect ruling and kingship, and they were accusing Him of being unfaithful, for He was withholding something from them, or so they believed. So we can see that's the very first time sin entered into the world. But we here today, we can see that we are equally as guilty as Adam and Eve. How about we do this? So God gave humanity 10 commandments. I hope we're all familiar with them. And on the bare minimum, they're just good moral law. Like, the bare minimum, at least. Yet, when we look at them, we see that we fail each and every one of them. Let's just take maybe some of the hopefully easier ones that we should be able to do, hopefully as all adults. How about this? How about lying? God says, for my glory and for your ultimate joy, you shall not lie. You should be a people of truth. Yet, I'm sure here today, if we took a tally of who has ever lied, those who are raising their hand would admit they're liars. For those who don't, agreeing, they're in the act of lying right now. And in doing so, we see that when we lie, we are rebelling against God's perfect ruling and kingship, and we're proclaiming in our actions, you, God, are unfaithful, for your truth is not good enough for me in this moment. How about stealing? God says, for my glory and for your ultimate joy, you shall not steal. Yet, I stand up here as a thief. When I have stolen, I have rebelled against God, his perfect rule and kingship, and in doing so, my actions proclaim you, God, are unfaithful. You won't provide for me. I will provide for myself. I am a bearer of God. How about this? God says, for my glory, for your joy, you shall not covet. Yet when we covet, we rebel, and we proclaim you, God, show favoritism. You're unfaithful. How about this? God says, you should not commit adultery. You should not commit lust. You should look at marriage in this right light. Yet when we lust or we walk against that, we are saying, you, God, your way is not good enough for me in this moment. I will create my own way. And we can do this with every single sin and see that we are all guilty. All sin is a direct rebellion against God, and it throws accusations against him. So I hope here today we can see that we're all in the same boat. We're all guilty. And now the question is, what is sin doing? We know what sin is, but what is it doing in our life? So when we look at the garden or the kingdom of God that he has established here on earth, he proclaimed to be good, he loved it, there was no fault in it. But when sin enters into the garden, we see sickness, death, hardship, but the worst thing of all, we see a spiritual death. For when God said to Adam and Eve, when you sin, if you eat from this tree, you shall surely die. And here today, we can go look for Adam and Eve and we won't find them, for they surely did die a physical death. But at the same time, in that moment, they had a spiritual death. Let me kind of paint it in this picture. A lot of time when humanity thinks about the human heart and sin, they may picture the heart like a diamond. And when sin comes into the picture, just simply splatter dirt and mud on the diamond. All you really have to do is just kind of wipe it clean with good deeds and good works for the diamond to be fully restored. But that's not the case with sin. For when we see sin enters into our life by our own guilt, we see it corrupts the diamond completely. It cracks it. The diamond is now distorted. Let's look at Genesis 6 very quickly. So Genesis 6 is only 4 chapters away from where God proclaimed humanity to be very good. And now sin enters into the world, and he says, the Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. This is a far cry from this is very good. Mark 7 says, For from within, out of the heart of man comes evil thoughts, sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, coveting, wickedness, deceit, sensuality, envy, slander, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person. Ezekiel 36 states that we have a heart of stone, a heart that is dead, stubborn, in wickedness and sin. Ephesians 2 says, all of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying in the cravings of our flesh and following in its desires. And like the rest, we were by nature deserving our wrath. So maybe you're here today and it's like, Matthew, I hear you, but I really don't agree with you. For when I look at my own heart, I don't see all of this evil, wickedness, deceit that you're talking about. For like, look at my resume here of all of these good deeds. For I actually try to love people. I actually try to do good. Like, look at all my good deeds. And I hear you, and at one point, I would be in the same boat as you. But what really helped me understand my own foolish, wicked, sinful heart was looking to the Pharisees. And I know the Pharisees usually get a bad rep because from the very moment we were in Sunday school, we were told, like, they're the bad guys, they were wrong. But we must understand, in the day and age of the biblical time of the Pharisees, they were the bar of righteousness almost. For on the outside, they were nailing it. For on the outside, they were doing all the right things. They knew their scripture well. They prayed unto God. They were actually concerned about holiness. They gave and fasted, gave to the poor. But yet, when Jesus comes into the picture, he calls them out. He says, yes, Pharisees, you never killed anyone like the Ten Commandments said, but you still hate people. That's the same root heart problem. Yes, you never commit adultery, but you still lust. Don't you see that the same heart sinful problem there? Yes, you know your scriptures well, but you don't know God. Yes, you give unto the poor and you pray out loud, but you do in front of everyone to lift yourself up. Yes, you give to the offering, but you neglect mercy and grace. And Jesus said something crazy to the people at the time, saying, if you want a shot back into the kingdom of God, you must have a greater righteousness than the Pharisees. And if the Pharisees were the bar, and they were nailing it, I hope here today we can see that we have no hope, for they did all the good deeds, they had a perfect resume, yet they weren't making it. So I hope here today we can see that despite our good deeds, our good works, whatever we try to do, our sinful heart is always right behind us, producing sin, wickedness, and evil. And it just kind of brings me to my last point on sin, and that is, what is the ultimate consequence of sin? And that is a place called hell. And I'm not sure, it's like, I know no one likes talking about it. I'm not even sure why I'm speaking about it now for my first sermon. Why am I bringing up this subject? For it's, you know, we have different ideas, but I'm not sure when you think about hell. Maybe you picture a place filled with fire with a devil with a pitchfork. And that is not the case exactly. Hell was created by God to forever subdue evil and sin and wickedness so that it may no longer wreak havoc on its creation. But when we look at our own sinful heart, we see that we fit a bill for such a place. I'm going to be careful with saying this. Here's the ultimate consequence of sin. That is, because hell is a place where wickedness, evil can only dwell, God cannot belong there. He removes his presence. And on the surface, we might say, sure, I can live in a place where God does not, his presence is not there. But when we look back at the first pillar of the gospel, we see how he is the perfection of holiness, perfection of goodness, perfection of righteousness. When you remove him from a place, only evil and wickedness dwells. And that's what the Bible is trying to push hard. That's why the Bible uses such harsh language as weeping and gnashing of teeth, where worm does not die and fire is not quenched, where there will be torment with fire and brimstone. It's trying to show us how awful of a place to be away from God. And that's, here's the ultimate consequence of sin. We are forever condemned away from from God's presence. And this reality of what sin is, what it is doing, and the ultimate consequence is right on the forefront of John's mind back here in Revelations. So let's jump back there to chapter 5, verse 1. Then I saw in the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writings on both sides and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaim in a loud voice, "Who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll?" So the question is, what is this scroll and why is it so important? And if we would stop the sermon and we would just read the rest of Revelations, we can see that someone is worthy to open this scroll. And because he is able to open the scroll, there is now a way back into the kingdom of God where we all stand condemned to be away from the presence of God and his kingdom. Because the scroll is open, there is a way back into God to be reconciled unto God once more. But please hear me say this. If this scroll is never open, there is no hope for me, there is no hope for you, there is no hope for John, there is no hope for humanity. And this realization is right on the forefront of John's mind, for he goes looking all over earth, all over heaven, to find someone who is able to open this scroll. But let's see what happens. Verse 3, but no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside it. In of himself, John is one unable to open the scroll to lead himself back unto God. But in of himself, he is unable to find someone who can open a scroll and lead himself back to God. And this is an awful reality. This is a hopeless state for John, for he knows his own guilt and he knows the ultimate consequence of sin. And there's only one thing left for him to do, and that is verse 4. I wept and wept because no one was found who was worthy to open the scroll or look inside. The only thing left for John to do was to weep and weep. And I hope here today there is room right alongside of John for us to weep and weep with him. For I hope here today we can see by our own guilt, we are unable to open the scroll in of ourselves, that we cannot lead us back unto God. And in of ourselves, we are unable to find someone who is worthy enough to lead us back to God. And I hope we can just weep and weep here this morning, right with John. Quite a hopeless state, such is the second pillar of the gospel. But the third pillar of the gospel will speak hope to this, and that is Jesus Christ the Savior is our third pillar of the gospel. How sweet, how amazing, how hopeful are these next words for John, for these next words where it give him hope to look upwards. And I hope here today these next words can be so sweet, so amazing, so hopeful for us here today. So let's continue this story, verse 5. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and the seven seals." Then I saw a lamb looking as it had been slain, standing at the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. The lamb had seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out to all the earth. He went and took the scroll from the right hand of him who sat on the throne. And when he had taken it, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the lamb. Each one had a harp, and they were holding golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of God's people. And they sang a new song, saying, "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation." How great are these words? For John, in of himself, could not open the scroll, could not find someone to open the scroll. But here comes someone who says, "Do not weep. Look, here comes this Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David. He is able to open the scroll and lead you back unto God where you have failed. He is able." But when that is what he hears. But when he looks, he sees a lamb. Kind of an oxymoron. Who is this Lion of a lamb who is able to open the scroll and lead humanity back unto God? Might be a little confusing. But not only that, this lamb who is present, this lamb appears to be slain. This lamb is soaked in its own blood. This lamb appears to have been dead at one point. But this lamb is currently living. So another oxymoron, who is this dead, living lamb? We might be confused. So the question is, who is this Lion of a lamb who is able to conquer and to open the scroll? And who is this Lion of a lamb who is slain but alive, who can open the scroll? And here today, this imagery might be a little bit confusing to us, for this imagery is not really strong with us, maybe. Maybe because we grew up in the church, it is. But for most people, not really, but this imagery, John knows exactly who this person is, for this imagery in the vision is very strong with John and his ancestors. So when he sees a bloody lamb, he is recalled back into a time when his ancestors for 500 years were held captive to Egypt. They were enslaved for 500 years. And for 500 years, they were abused, misused, mistreated. And for 500 years, they called out to God for deliverance, and God heard their prayers. So God took Moses and built him up and sent him back into Egypt to go to Pharaoh, the king of the day. And God told Moses told Pharaoh, "Let my people go." But Pharaoh hardens his heart and says, "No, you will be forever my slaves." So God gives Moses power to do 10 plagues upon Egypt to convince Pharaoh to let his people go. But after each and every plague, he hardens his heart and says, "No, you'll be forever my slaves." That was true until the very last plague. What was that plague? God told Moses, and Moses told the Israelites, "This very night, death will enter into all of Egypt, both on the Egyptians and both on the Israelites. And when death comes, he will kill the firstborn son of every family." And I hope here today we can imagine the sheer panic and chaos that would be happening at this news. For everyone was about to lose a loved one. Or if you're like me, the firstborn son of the family, I don't want to be here at this point. I'm going to die that very night if I was there. But God provides a way out. God tells Moses, who told the Israelites, you can be saved by the Passover Lamb. And hopefully we can see the connection starting to form between the Passover Lamb and Revelations. So God told Moses, if you go out and find a lamb that has no blemish, and you kill that lamb, and you put the blood of the lamb on your door frame, and as long as you are in and under the blood of the lamb, you will be spared. So sure enough, they go out into all of their flocks, find a lamb that has no blemish, and they kill that lamb and put the blood on their door frame. And that night, as long as they were in and under the blood of the Passover lamb, they were spared. And that night, they surely were, but the Egyptians who had no blood of the lamb, they were not. Therefore, the Passover lamb became a very powerful symbol of the idea that the penalty of death could be paid by the death of another. What God is trying to do here throughout time, he's trying to imprint this idea on the hearts of his people that, hey, your death can be paid by the death of another. But not only that, he actually strengthens the symbolization all the more in the years to come. For when they actually do escape Egypt, God demands that once a year, you should go to the temple and bring an animal that has no blemish upon the altar, and you should kill it. And when the blood runs over, your sins for the past year will be covered. And we know that God, the Bible is very clear that the God is not after these animal sacrifices, as these sacrifices does not please God when it just comes to the sacrifice itself. But what God is trying to do in these moments is he's trying to imprint this idea, this ideology on their hearts that one, sin equals death. Where you have sin, your rightful punishment is death. But he gives hope by saying that sin can be covered by the death of another. Therefore, the Passover lamb became an even more powerful symbol of the idea that the penalty of death, especially for one's sins, could be paid by the death of another. And for years to come, God is just trying to imprint this idea on the hearts of his people that sin equals death, but one day a sacrifice can be made to forever cleanse our sin. And he did it for years upon years until finally Jesus enters the picture. Jesus is born of a virgin to be human, but sent of God and is God, thus making him holy, 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 perfect in righteousness, perfect in goodness. Let's hear what John the Baptist, different from John, the author of Revelation, John the Baptist says about Jesus when Jesus begins his ministry. He says, John 1 says, the next day, John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. So John the Baptist is saying, look, for years and years and years, we've been doing these sacrifices to align our hearts with the truth that our sin equals death, but one day someone can come to forever cleanse us. And he's saying, look to Jesus. Here is our Messiah. He is the Lamb of God, able to take away our sins. Let's hear what Jesus says about himself when he begins his ministry. He says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. So Jesus is saying, look back to this one kingdom that God has established where God is on the throne, holy, 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 where for everything he does is for his glory and for our ultimate joy, and all creation should be in right submission, right worship to this God. Yet, we, through sin and our own guilt, have rebelled against God and are forever condemned to be away from his presence. He is saying, this kingdom is once again near through me, for I can forgive your sins and you can be once again welcomed back into this kingdom. And the crazy thing that Jesus does is he actually proves he has authority to forgive sins by undoing the curse of sin itself. So where we could look at the kingdom of God, how it was perfect, and when sin entered into the world, there was sickness, death, demonic forces. When Jesus comes into the picture, he is undoing that curse. He tells the blind to see, the mute to speak, the crippled to walk, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. On multiple occasions, he goes to tombs or on deathbed, and he tells the dead to rise again, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. And on multiple occasions, people are bringing their family members or friends or people who are possessed by demons, and say, can you heal them? And God, or Jesus, rebukes the demons and says, you must flee, for the kingdom of heaven has come near. But do you remember how I said the ultimate thing when sin entered the world was a spiritual death? So how did Jesus undo that spiritual death? Can you remember back in Revelations where the Lamb was able to open the scroll and lead us back unto God? That Lamb was slain. Jesus Christ gave himself over to the Jewish and Roman authorities to be crucified on the cross. Not only 2 weeks ago, Cherry Glade did an amazing Easter plague showing what God has done here on earth through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ on the cross. So I hope here today we can have that same strong imagery still in our mind as we continue out. But maybe you weren't there, or maybe you already forgot. Let me remind you of what the Bible says happened when Jesus died on that cross. Galatians tells us that Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. So on that cross, he is undoing the curse of sin. He is undoing the curse of the spiritual death. 2 Corinthians says, God made him who had no sin be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So that when he died on that cross, it was not just a normal death, but when he died, he took my sin and my guilt and humanity's sin and guilt off of us and put it upon himself, and he died to it. 1 Peter says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness, for by his wounds we have been healed. So when we are in and under the blood of Jesus Christ, not only does he take our sin and our guilt upon himself and dies on the cross, but in return, he gives us his perfect righteousness put upon our lives. He takes our sin and guilt. He gives us Jesus' perfect righteousness upon our life. So please hear me say this. In the same way, when death back in Egypt passed over the houses of the Israelites by the Passover lamb, and they were spared, in the same way, as long as we're in and under the blood of Jesus Christ and have his righteousness put upon us, when God looks at us, he no longer sees our guilt, our sin, and our wickedness, but he sees the perfection of Jesus' righteousness upon my life and upon your life if we are in and under the blood of Jesus Christ. But the question remains, if Christ died to our sins and he remained dead, what does that say about sin? Is that us saying our sin was greater than Jesus if he is truly still dead today? But that is not the case. Can we look back to Revelations and where this slain lamb that was all bloody was able to open the scroll? That lamb died, but that lamb was no longer dead. For on the third day, breath was entered into Jesus' lungs, and in doing so, he conquered the grave and sin on our behalf because we could not. Romans 8 says, who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, was raised to life, and is at the right hand of God, and also interceding for us. So Romans is saying, look, we were all rightfully condemned to be away from the presence of God forever by our own guilt and our own sin. But because Christ died on the cross and rose again from the dead, he's saying, who can condemn you? No one. For that sin that once condemned you is now dead on the cross. It is no more. When God looks upon you, he sees Jesus' perfect righteousness. Let's reread Revelations with this new light of this information. You, Jesus Christ, are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain on the cross, and with your blood on the cross, you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and a priest to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth. Jesus Christ is a lion who came who triumphed, who is able to open the scroll because he conquered the grave and sin on our behalf because we could not. And he is able to open the scroll and lead us back unto God. And Jesus Christ is a slain living lamb who died on the cross but rose again, who is able to lead us back unto God. And that is the third pillar of the gospel. And now the only question that remains is, how do we get in and under the blood of Jesus Christ? For it's not automatically applied to everyone, but we must be in and under. In the same way, the Israelites had to put the blood on the door frame. They were spared, but the Egyptians were not. How do we get the blood and resurrection of Jesus Christ on our life? And that is the fourth pillar of the gospel, our faith, our response, faith and repentance. The question is, what is faith? Faith is a God-given ability to see the other three pillars of the gospel and to say, it is only through you, Jesus Christ alone, I have hope of salvation. Putting your faith in Jesus Christ is simply saying, I cannot do this, but you can. May I be welcomed in and under your blood and your death, and can I have your perfect righteousness put upon me as you kill my sin and guilt upon the cross. Putting your faith in Christ means you are utterly renouncing any other hope of being counted righteous before God. One day, the Bible says, we will all have to give an account unto God for our life. And for those who are Christians, for those who follow Christ, for those who are in and under the blood of Jesus Christ, we have one plea and one plea alone. And that is not anything I have done, but everything Christ Jesus has accomplished in his death and his resurrection. Not anything I have done, but everything Christ Jesus did on the cross and on the empty tomb. So what is repentance? Repentance and putting God back on the throne of our life, where we once, God was rightfully on the throne, and we were supposed to be in right submission, in right worship, but we rebelled against God, we threw accusation against God, we were traitors and enemies of God at one point. We now say, God, will you once again roll over my life? Will you once again be put on the throne of my life so I can walk in right submission and right worship to you for your glory and for my ultimate joy? But remember, this was once impossible, for sin was the issue, for it corroded our heart completely, where our heart was only bent towards evil and sin and wickedness, and we had no hope. But something amazing happens when we put our faith in Jesus Christ. Ezekiel 36 states, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. I will remove the heart of your stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. So when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, God removes our dead, wicked, evil stone of the heart and throws it aside, for it's truly dead. And he gives us a new heart that isn't alive, that is beating. It's all an analogy, but he gives us a new heart with his spirit within us. So now that we now finally have hope of saying, God, rule over my life. And can I actually walk in the same holiness that you walk in? And let me say this quickly. Now that we have hope of walking in the same holiness, not that we are perfect, not that we will never sin again, and that's the far extreme. The other extreme is that now these good works that I'm now doing under the new heart and his righteousness and his holiness, those works does not earn us salvation into heaven or into the kingdom of God or into his presence. What was that? That was Christ and Christ alone on the cross. But now for his glory and for our ultimate joy, we can walk in life. Let's finish out chapter 5 of Revelation, verse 11. Then I looked and heard the voice of many angels, numbering thousands upon thousands and 10,000s upon 10,000s. They encircled the throne and the living creatures and the elders. In a loud voice, they were saying, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the seas and all in them saying, for those who are in and under the blood of Jesus Christ through faith and repentance, here is where we chime in. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. The four living creatures said amen, and the elders fell down and worshiped. when we are in and under the blood of Jesus Christ, we can now say, to him who sits on the throne, holy, 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 you God, Lord Almighty, who was and is to come. And to the Lamb, Jesus Christ, perfect in goodness, perfect in righteousness, be praise, honor, glory, power, forever and ever. And that is the last pillar of the gospel. So I hope here today we have at least a clear picture, the big picture of what God has done here on earth. And maybe you're here today in the audience and it's like, Matthew, yes and amen, but you forgot to say this about God. Or Matthew, you forgot to say this about Jesus. You forgot to say this about faith and repentance. Whatever it may be, I would say, I know. I agree. I wish I had another hour with you here today. I wish I had another Sunday, another week, another year, another century, for we can be forever growing in this good news of the gospel. But the question is right now, what do we do with the knowledge? However big or small, maybe today's the first day you heard it, or maybe you heard it from age zero to now, maybe whatever it may be, what do we do with this good news that we now know? So first, let me talk to those who are not in and under the blood of Jesus Christ, who has not given your faith to Jesus Christ yet. Here is my hope and my prayer for you here today. My hope, will you, at a bare minimum, will you at least ponder what you have heard here today? For this is truly the best news you will ever hear, and it is truly an invitation in. Maybe you have some questions, maybe not. Maybe I made no sense up here today, but you know there's something there. Most likely, you came with a friend, you came with a family member. Will you just, whatever questions, whatever hurdles, whatever you have, will you just talk with them here today? Or maybe you just randomly came into this church, you had no one here. Know that you have me, you have our pastors, you have anyone who is in and under the blood of Jesus Christ. We would love just to walk with you, answer some questions with you. And maybe you're here today and you want to give your yes to Christ. You want your sin, your guilt to be dead on the cross, and you want his righteousness put upon you. If that's you here today, once again, will you talk with that family member? Will you talk with that friend? Will you talk with me? Will you talk to a pastor? Not that we do anything, but we would love just to welcome you into the church of God. Not that we do anything, but we would just love to walk with you, guide with you. Know that here today, you have an invitation back into the presence of God. And that's my hope and my prayer for you today. Now, to those who are already Christians, let me ask you this. Maybe you already had this knowledge. Maybe everything I said to you here today, you already knew. 2 weeks ago, Dan Tice did an amazing message, and a lot of our material actually overlapped. So maybe you knew it 2 weeks ago. Or maybe last week, Robert gave an amazing Easter sermon. So maybe you already had that knowledge yesterday. So maybe you already had this knowledge. Does that mean this sermon is pointless for you here today? And I would say, by no means, not at all. And the reason is, Paul, who wrote most of the New Testament of the Bible, is constantly reminding the church of this gospel. He is constantly pointing them back to this good news of the gospel. For Paul wants the church to know and to grasp this gospel. For he knows in everyday life, we must be rooted in this gospel. And very quickly, give me maybe 5 more minutes and I'll wrap this up. Let me just prove to you that we are in utter need of this gospel. Let's just do everyday life, everyday practical life. Who is here married? And maybe especially for the husbands, the Bible says we as husbands should love our wife like Christ loved the church. Now, what hope do I have of loving my wife well like Christ loved the church if I'm not rooted in this gospel? I'm in utter need of this gospel to love my wife well. How about this generosity? God says we should be a people who are generous. Our hearts should flow with generosity. But when I look at my own heart, I can be pretty stingy at times, not wanting to be generous. But when I'm rooted in this gospel, I can see how God was forever gracious or generous with me by giving up his own life on the cross. In the same way, I can be generous with others. How about this? Patience. We're supposed to be patient with each other. Do you have any parents in the room? I know I have a child on the way, and one day this child is going to test my patience to the max. Now, what hope do I have of being patient with my child, with my wife, with everyday people, if it's not first rooted in the gospel, realizing how God was so patient with me when I was his enemy, when I was walking in sinful and wickedness? He was patient with me. How about one more? Here's a very hard one. We're supposed to love and to pray for those who hate us, for those who want to do us harm, for those who disagree with us, those who want to persecute us. Now, there is nothing in my heart that wants me to love and pray for those who hate me. There's nothing there. But when I'm rooted in this gospel, I can see that I was once an enemy of God, but he lavished his love upon me. So in the same way, I can lavish my love on my enemies in hope that they see Christ as well. And this is everyday practical life. And I hope we can do this with every single day and we see that we are in desperate need of this gospel. But maybe just not everyday life. How about this? When was the last time we did a heart check? When was the last time we just quieted our spirit and just looked within our heart? For I am constantly trying to drown out what's really happening in my heart by entertainment or busyness. How about we do this here today? Who is at this point, just being honest here today, maybe it's a family situation, maybe it's a marital issue, maybe it's a child, maybe it's an in-law, whoever may be over here, or maybe it's something at work, a coworker, a boss, a project, or maybe it's something in your community, in your family, or maybe it's something upon yourself, a disorder, ailment, disease, whatever it may be. Are you at this point when you just talk with God? Just, God, I give up. I can no longer do this. For I've been putting all my energy and effort into fixing this moment, but I'm seeing no fruit. I give up. I have no more willpower. If that is you here today, can this gospel speak to you? Can it encourage you? It sure can. Can we not look at the second pillar of the gospel where we were weeping with John and had no hope? But then we heard the sweet voice of Jesus saying, hey, look to the cross, look to the empty grave, see how I am faithful. Can we take that same faithfulness and apply it to our situation here today and say, God, I give up. I can no longer do this. But God, you are faithful. You can make a way. I may not be able to see it, but you can make a way. Or how about this? Maybe when you look at your heart, maybe there's a past sin that just really eats you up. And when you think about it, it just eats you up. It just makes you feel sick to your stomach. And there's just so much shame and so much guilt right now. And that shame is reading lies upon you and just saying, if your friends and your family only knew, they would realize what a fraud you are. Or if God knew, he wouldn't have died for you on the cross. Why are you kidding? And there's just so much shame there. If that's you here today, can this gospel encourage you? It sure can. Let me ask you, is Christ dead or alive? He is alive. That sin is nailed on the cross. It is dead. And Jesus' perfect righteousness is put upon you. When God looks at you, he sees perfection. The Bible actually says he sings over us when we're in and under the blood of Jesus Christ. And maybe you're in this weird stage where you have this new heart, but you're still struggling with like past sins, and you're just in this feel like a helpless state. Who was the one who saved us to begin with? It was Christ. So why would we run away from the one who ultimately saved us? Isn't God patient? Isn't Jesus patient? Won't he, you know, pick us back up, walk with us? Maybe run to the Father. Or one more, I promise. Maybe it's not your sin upon your life that makes you feel sick to your stomach. Maybe it's a sin of another person put upon your life. Maybe, God forbid, you were misused, abused, mistreated, put in a situation you were never supposed to be in. People spoke wrongly about you. Whatever it is, it's not your sin, but the sins of another person put upon you. And there's just so much shame and guilt that makes you feel sick to your stomach. If that's you here today, can this gospel encourage you? It sure can. Let me ask you, who is your creator? It is God who created you. Look to him. He defines you. He made you. You were created from his being. He calls you son and daughter when you're in and under the blood of Jesus Christ. So I hope today we can see that every heart-wrenching issue, every part of life, we are in utter need of this gospel. And I don't want to be naive here today. I know that we simply just don't take the knowledge of the gospel and we just throw out all our problems and they disappear. But I have tried that, and I still struggle with some of these things I said here today. But here's the power of knowing the knowledge of the gospel. The power is not the knowledge of the gospel. The power is a God of the gospel. The one who points, when we know and grasp and have it in our gut, it always lifts our eyes up to the one who can make everything, they can change everything, make everything possible. So in closing, Trevor, if you want to come up, I have maybe one more minute. So the question is, how do we give this gospel into our heart, into our gut? So first, put your faith and repentance in Christ and Christ alone. That's the first step. Two, maybe we'd be forever growing in this knowledge of the gospel. There's so much more to be known. I surely know more today than I did a year ago. And I sure hope in a year from now, I know more about this gospel. But here's my challenge for us here today. What would happen if daily we would reflect upon this gospel to help us get this knowledge into our gut? What would happen if daily we would look at God on his throne, holy, 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 perfect in goodness, perfect in righteousness, where everything he does is for his glory and for our ultimate joy, and we just learn to be at his feet and say, God, can you help me to love you all the more and learn all the more about you? And what would happen daily if we would just humble ourselves and see that we have sinned and we need a Savior? Something great happens when we weep and weep. We can so much easier hear Jesus Christ saying, look to the cross, look to the empty tomb. Look how your sin and your guilt is no more. Who condemns you? No one. For my righteousness is put upon you. And what will happen if daily we will look at faith and repentance and say, God, what does it mean here today to say, I am all in on you, Christ. You are my only hope in my salvation. And what would it mean here today to say, God, I want you on the throne of my life. How can I walk in holiness? What evil and sin can I fight here today? How can you be glorified? And how can I find ultimate joy here today? Here is my hope and prayer for Cherry Glade. I want us to know and to grasp this good news of what God has done, and that everything we can do can be rooted in this gospel. And I'm just saying, I'm happy to belong to a church where I see this gospel happening here among us. And I'm excited to see how we can continue to grow in this gospel and see where God might have us next. Thank you for having me. I love you, Cherry Glade. Trevor, will you lead us out?
I invite you to stand.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show Jesus, the only one you could ever say. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes. With your heart and lead me in your love.
for your gospel. Thank you that your blood covers us, that you made a way back to the Father. The grace that you've given us, we do not deserve. Lord, would you root us in your love? Would you build our lives upon that? Lead us as we go this week. May we share this great news of your gospel and your love, Jesus Christ. In your name we pray these things. Amen. Thank you, and you're dismissed.